Hello, CosPodders, and welcome to episode 14. We're getting a fantastic
and amazing journey!
Yes, we would like to welcome any new listeners and watchers that we have. We are CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay, and I'm Amber.
I'm Valerie. Hi.
Nice to meet you! Hey, we're getting new watchers and listeners all the time, so, you know, we have to welcome the new people.
Our Facebook page has been expanding, which makes me really happy because I've been redesigning it and making it fancy and pretty. So,
speaking of redesign, I guess we can talk about this in just a second, but we ended up getting a lot of feedback on our website, and that will be going under a massive redesign.
Right.
So don't be surprised if you see some weird stuff on the site when the next episode drops. I am working frantically on it, don't get me wrong, but...
It takes a lot of time.
Well, it does, especially since, you know, you're going to school.
Yeah.
I'm about to be going back to school, and in fact, I'm already studying even though I'm not officially in classes. And we both work constantly.
Exactly.
At our jobs. So between that, and I know you're frantically doing cosplay for A-Fest.
Mm-hmm.
Sadly, I don't have that luxury.
I don't know how I'm finding the time, to be honest. I'm guessing my insomnia is helping me.
Do you have a bag of holding somewhere? If so, may I borrow it?
I think I have little, like, underpants gnomes that do the sewing for me or something. That's the only explanation that I have at this point.
Well, I prefer elves to gnomes, but hey, each their own.
Their own.
I'll do the sewing myself. I don't mind. I just need a little bit of extra time for all the little things, like...
Yeah.
Tracing the patterns onto the fabric that takes forever. Cutting out the pieces that takes forever.
You know what?
The
only thing I want right now is for the heat and the humidity to kind of die down because I'm on my fifth resin casting. It's just melting everything. And at this point, I am tempted to just go online and hope I don't have to spend $500 on some gems.
Don't even start with me about the heat. For those who don't know, I'm a motorcyclist.
Yeah.
And I ride in full long armor. In fact...
Oh, she goes up and goes to pull it out.
This is my armor jacket. It is bumblebee yellow so that people don't miss me when I'm riding in traffic and I don't become a road pancake. But as you can see, it has nice long sleeves and this is not terribly well ventilated. So, yeah, I know all about the heat and humidity intimately for 6 months out of the year.
Exactly.
Don't mind throwing things on as I heave my jacket onto my bed so it can go play nice with my helmet.
There you go.
My friends, I'm sure, still want to put the little antenna on my helmet because I have a yellow jacket and a black helmet and a black bike, so I look like the bumblebee, and they want to put little antenna on my helmet so I look like one.
Yeah, that's hot.
That was not the reaction I expected. This is why I hide my helmet from people like that. No, thank you. But it saves a lot of money, so, you know...
That's why you do it.
When I'm not paying in gas, I can put toward cosplay.
There you go.
But what little I have left over. But...
Yeah, website redesign.
Yeah, we're talking about feedback. Did you want to talk about the conference?
Yeah, I went to the Rooster Teeth Expo this past weekend. So when this releases, it will have been exactly a week ago. For those who don't know, Rooster Teeth is a company who kind of started doing machinima stuff, particularly with Halo movies like Red versus Blue. If you know what Red versus Blue is, just go Google it and it'll make all the sense in the world.
You can call machinima too.
Yeah, it's basically a gaming convention meets the internet, so there were a ton of podcasters there, and I had a chance to sit down, go out to dinner with them, chat with them, and get some immediate feedback about what they liked and didn't like about our show. So that's one of the reasons why we are redesigning the living crap out of our website.
Among other things. Yes. Although actually we did get feedback that the website currently looks rather professional. But
yeah.
We will leave it up, of course, to the audience for you all to tell us which website version you like better.
Yeah.
Because it's not really for us. We kind of know what we're doing. Mostly.
Sort of.
Show to show.
Most of the time, at least.
We try to know what we're doing. Yeah. And if we don't, then we figure out how we're going to wing it instead. But Yes, that is something else we are working on among all of our other cos projects. Although, I actually don't have any cos projects I'm working on at the moment.
Simply
because of school.
School, yeah. I don't know how... I don't know how I'm actually doing things. I basically have two jobs now, so...
Well, I mean, the extra income helps. Oh, don't get me wrong. I'm actually looking at doing one cos project between now and A-Fest, because that's pretty much all I'm going to have time for, since I actually have something else that's taking up my time, but I don't want to mention that right now. It will be talked about later if it happens. But I'm trying to pull off redoing Deedlit from Record of Lotus War.
Mm-hmm.
I already have all the parts cut out, because the costume's been made once before. But it was back when I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't
when you were still a cosplay newbie.
Well, it was to where I didn't know about lining for the arm side.
Yeah.
For sleeveless costumes. I didn't know like how to properly use that piece, so I sewed them on like little capped sleeves. It was cute. And now that I look at it, I'm like, oh my god, I
like,
can't
what the heck was I thinking?
What was I doing? And there's other things, like I never really finished the hem.
Right.
I cheated and used purchased bias tape, which wasn't quite the same color as the rest of the fabric anyway, so now I can do my own. And, you know, there's just little things that I would like to redo. I'd like to iron it as well, because heaven knows there's nothing that ruins a cosplay more than having wrinkles everywhere. So I'm going to attempt it. I can't swear I'll have it for A-Fest, but I will certainly try. I'd love to redo the armor, too, since I've got all this EVA foam lying around. I just need to order my heat gun, which was kind of put off to the side when I suddenly went, holy crap, school wants my tuition the day I register.
Yep.
Which is fine. You know, I'm going to community college, so it's not quite as bad. But still, you know,
that's a chunk. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, my college tuition this semester would purchase me 3 cosplays. At the rate that it takes me to get materials. That's 3 cosplays for 1 semester of college. Not including books.
So. You have fun with those books.
Maybe I'll start a cosplay club on campus.
There you go.
I should totally do that if somebody hasn't already started one.
Probably isn't one.
There's a few colleges that have anime clubs, but not cosplay clubs. Because that's something else there.
Do it.
I'll have to look
at it.
Because there's always some interesting people that attend college. Really awesome people.
Interesting is putting it mildly.
I was tame the first time I went to college. I'm actually going back
to
college for a second degree. But the first time I went, I was so plain Jane. You know, never going out and partying, never having fun. Study, study, study. Get the grades, do the homework.
Yeah, that was
straight-laced.
See, that was my thing too, but I also went to a really expensive school, and I was like, my ass is not going to get really crappy grades because I can't afford to lose my scholarships, which require me to have practically a near-perfect GPA. So, yeah.
Yeah.
That sucked.
I really kind of wish, and I've said this before, but I really wish that there were some colleges or trade schools that offered cosplay-type classes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, not to where you had to go in and get a fashion designer degree, because fashion design is a little more broad than cosplay, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Cosplay has a set of specialized skills.
Yeah.
You know, like metalworking, like leatherworking, like patterning, like fabric and material choices. I know it's part of fashion designer, but just that class is standalone with no prerequisites, nothing else you have to take concurrently, you know.
Exactly.
You're not working toward a degree, you just want mm-hmm. these one-off classes, almost like auditing. But I have yet to find a place that offers leatherworking or metalworking in the style that cosplay needs it, not like metalworking that you'd find with a smith in a forge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is more like jewelry and armor style metalworking.
Yeah.
Not making, you know, spurs, because cosplayers generally don't need those. Not to mention, cosplayers generally don't have access to a forge.
Forge, yeah.
Although I have seen awesome instructions online on instructions on how to make your own backyard forge. It is awesome. Cosplayers, if you ever want to know how to do anything under the sun, it never hurts to search Instructables. Someone will have done it and made an Instructable on it at some point.
That's awesome.
It's fantastic. In fact, I'm working from an Instructable right now on how to build articulated wings. In fact, you can Google how to make articulated wings, and that should be the first result that comes up.
I know which one you're talking about.
It's really, really cool.
It's really nifty. Oh, so cool. I thought about doing that with my last costume, but I was like, okay, that's just too much. I'm not going to do that.
Well, I saw a couple of comments later in the article, if you go through and read the comments, that there are apparently substituted parts you can use that make it a little less expensive, since I guess some of the collars and some of the washers and such were expensive.
Expensive, yeah.
Unless you buy in bulk. One of these days, we're going to have this cosplayers consortium, where we will buy things in bulk for our members and then just sell them at discounted prices just for the cosplay members.
Yeah.
And if I ever win the lottery or if I ever get rich, I want to have a workroom or a garage set aside in my house that cosplayers can just come and pay $5 for and use the entire day, and it will be full of power tools and sewing machines and sergers and industrial leather machines and all this really cool stuff if I ever win the lottery.
I'm just having like this little dream cloud going up over my head right now. Like, aww.
I don't have a dream cloud. I have a dream fog. It's everywhere. I dream big.
Yeah, you do.
And this is why my comments usually end with, my ambition is greater than my talent sometimes. Because it's very true. But hey, you know, if you don't dream big, you can't score big.
Exactly.
So you may as well start from somewhere.
I like this theory. So of course, you got to get you to actually play the lotto. That would be step one.
Philosophically, I think the lotto is a tax on people that can't do math. But
you're here.
If you don't play, then you don't win. But frankly, you know, if I have a chance to spend the dollar and not win, but if I kept the dollar, I know I could buy something for that dollar and get something for sure, even if it's not a lotto win. Save the dollar, you know. That dollar could buy me a yard of fabric. Or two, if it's
the
price at the Joanne's red tag sale.
Oh yeah, did you end up getting your Joanne coupons in the mail today? Because, oh my god.
I haven't had a chance to check the mail, because we literally started recording, like, almost as soon as I stopped eating dinner, which was right after I walked in the door.
I was about to say,
drinking, you know, my little sparkling ice orange mango drink, too, because this is kind of
nice.
They're not sponsoring me, they don't pay me to say this, but this stuff is fantastic.
But to say, if you don't want to spend money, don't open the last page, because it will make your eyes turn into pinwheels, and I'm already planning out my next trip, when I really shouldn't be.
Whenever any craft fabric hobby type store holds sales, I don't even have to see the circular to want to buy stuff, because there are perpetually things I would love to have in my collection. Like, those really, really nice scrapbooking and or fabric paints that I know you started using. I would love to have a full set of those. I would love to have tools. I would love to get a hot knife type tool that you can also use for leather working, for stamping.
Yeah.
Love to have one of those. I need to replace half my acrylic paints because I use them so seldom that they dry up before I end up using them again. Then I have to replace them all again.
Right.
If I get the top quality ones, it doesn't matter. Acrylic paint eventually dries out.
Dries out.
Cosplay tip of the day. Paints dry out eventually, no matter how good they are.
Yeah, they always dry out. And it sucks.
You can nurse some of them back to health a little bit.
A little bit.
But even then, the quality is not the same as the original, even if you doctor it.
Exactly.
So, you know, there's tons of things that I would love to have. But,
money, money, and more money. Yay!
Money, I do not has it.
Yeah.
Yet.
So, I'm really proud of myself at my last trip to Joanne's, which was last weekend. I only spent $23 and I saved over $50. Wow. And it's for costumes that I won't be making until next year. So I was just like, heck yeah, I'm set, man.
Yeah, I know that Black Friday isn't for a couple of months.
Yeah.
But Black Friday is the one day a year when my budget at Joanne's just skyrockets, because I set aside money specifically for that day so that I can stock up on basic things that I know I will use a lot of during the year, like white broadcloth, black cloth, interfacing, muslin, a thread in all sorts of colors. What else do I normally get? Paint, if I need paint to stock up. I get new paintbrushes at that point, because I need them. If I ever need new needles or notions, I get those. You know, it's just the basic things that you know you're going to use over and over again, because that's when the coupons are best.
Yeah.
That and Half Price are the only two places I'm willing to set foot on Black Friday. There are crazy, crazy people on the road, and if you ever want the most calm, quiet, good-mannered Black Friday ever, aside from just staying home the whole day, go to your local Half-Price Books or bookstore like Borders or Barnes & Noble.
Because nothing's going on there.
Nerds are not going to sit there and fight you for your place in line. Book nerds are not going to give you evil glares when you pull up in your car, holding hot coffee that they don't have. Book nerds will even share donuts with you.
Yes, and they will.
If they have it.
Unless you're reading Twilight, then they might smack you.
Well, if you're reading odd things, then you might get the nasty look. But, you know, nerds are like the most sedate, good-natured people you can be with on a Black Friday.
Yeah.
Because they're all in the same boat, and you all have something in common.
Yep.
You love books, and this is where you're choosing to spend your Black Friday.
I don't know if I'm going to make my Black Friday this year, because usually I'm working on holidays. Even I've worked through Thanksgiving, I've worked through Christmas, but now I'm at a job where I have those holidays off. So I'm tempted to actually make that trip on Black Friday. I don't know if I want to, but I'm tempted.
I have it off, but with going to school this year, I think my budget's going to be a lot more limited.
Yeah.
So I may end up dropping Half Price this year. And unfortunately going to Joanne's. Because the reason I say unfortunately about Joanne's is simply because that there are some very avid crafters who will fight you for what's in your cart.
Yes.
That's all I'm going to say about that. So I guess at this point, we have tutorials and segments for you.
We do, so let's keep rolling. Yay!
Alright guys, Val/T5 from CosPod here, and I'm going to show you a different way to do fabric dyeing that use fabric paint, which I know sounds really weird and very counterintuitive, but you're going to run across these situations where you want a particular color that doesn't really come in dyes, and to try to get that color in a dye is a pain in the butt, because you end up mixing multiple colors, and sometimes it comes out too light, comes out too dark, sometimes it comes out too brown or too blue. So for me, I found the best way of doing this is to take fabric paint in the color that you want and then mix it in almost like you're doing it as a dye. Things that you're going to need are a nice glass of very hot water, not so hot that you can't like stick your hand into it, but hot enough like you would typically do with fabric dye. The paint that you're going to want to use, the bucket where you're going to want to stick your paints in, some type of stirring device. I just happened to use a plastic fork because it was readily available. Your fabric, but you also want to get a test swatch because you want to make sure the color is right before you start doing it with all your fabric. Lots of paper towels, which will make sense in a little bit. And then your surface on which you're going to have all your stuff dry. I like to use either cardboard or the interior of paper bags. Because I find like with newspaper or even with paper towels, it tends to leave a weird imprint in the dyeing process and I don't like to mess with it. Okay, so first thing you're going to want to do is try to get your color combined. And the other reason that you want to do this is, say you have a piece of fabric this long and I want to dye the entire thing, Hand painting this would take me forever and a day and would be very inconsistent. That's why dyeing comes in. Okay. The next part is to add in your water. As you notice, I used almost a full cup of water and maybe about that much of paint. It's going to be predominantly water. And then you want to mix like mad. Mix it because paint has a tendency to clump, especially when you've just doused it with a lot of water. And the last thing that you want to do is run your fabric through it and have these weird little clumps of inconsistent paint colors all over your fabric. So you stir like mad to make sure that all the paint has dissipated into the water. Alright, the next thing you want to do is take your paper towel, fold it up into a square, and then run it along the bottom of your paint cup. And this is to help remove any extra paint that's sitting on the bottom that didn't stir properly. See, this is the fun part. This is where you just kind of have to let it sit and play and see what you can make happen. I mean, sometimes it's just as simple as letting it sit and rest. Actually, the cool thing I like about this technique is that you don't even have to run it underwater to remove the extra paint. Fabric paint is there to become absorbed by the fabric. You know, it doesn't run, it doesn't wear out, it just is. So there you go. That's my really simple, quick, easy method of using fabric paint as fabric dye. For when you want to do very large areas in a very particular color that may not be readily available. And now the fun part, watching it dry. Drying time can take anywhere from 1 to 5 hours, depending upon the concentration of your paint and how much fabric there needs to be dried up. But there you have it.
And we're back.
Yay.
Hopefully you enjoyed that segment. It was very informative.
And crazy and kooky, because that's what I do best.
Yes, well, you know, being normal is kind of boring sometimes.
Being normal is very boring. I like being a unique individual.
I say that lovingly, with tongue in cheek, because sometimes normal is necessary. But it's kind of boring sometimes, you gotta admit.
I don't know why I'm bouncing my head, but I just heard the Dallas theme song playing in the background. Somebody out there is watching TV, and I'm like, this is some good timing, man.
It's better than what I usually get out my window, which is heavy bass. Oh. Hey, turn it down there, whippersnappers. I feel so old sometimes. I really
yeah.
do. I'm not that old.
No, we're not.
Get off my lawn.
Damn kids.
But at any rate, being old brings wisdom, which we shall parlay into CosPhilosophy. I am a little sad that we didn't have anybody sign up for our roundtable this time around. It may have just been bad timing because it was right around 4th of July holiday. Yay, 4th of July!
Yay.
We took lots of pictures. But we shall discuss, among us, criticism in cosplay.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to have you start because when you first proposed the topic, I was like, okay, this could go in a billion different directions. How the heck are we going to tailor this?
Hopefully I'm going to narrow it down to 4 directions from the infinite that it could have gone, just because I will tangent onto every single one of them given enough time.
Yep.
So, there's a couple different ways you can receive criticism, and there's a couple different ways you can give it. And those two ways are as a cosplayer, someone who's been in the business for a while, and someone who's not a cosplayer or non-cosplayer. And I know that there are slang names for people who are not cosplayers, but I'm not going to use them, so I'm just going to term it as non-cosplayer, just for the sake of argument.
Because some of them are actually legitimate good criticisms, and some of them are just jerks being jerks criticisms, so.
And in all categories, you will have the jerks just being jerks.
Oh yeah.
They exist. But first, I guess we should probably cover, as cosplayers, since that's what we have the most experience with at this point, receive it. Because that's usually what when people think of when you think of criticism as cosplay is, you know, how are people going to perceive my costume? And criticism, of course, comes from critique, which is evaluating a costume. It's not necessarily bad. Usually people will put the word constructive in front of it so that you don't get the feeling that, you know, someone's going to suddenly come down hard in a negative fashion on costume.
Right.
So criticism is just simply evaluating someone's costume. And everyone has their own criteria on how they judge a costume. You know, there's always accuracy. There's, do you look personally like the character you are portraying? There's the materials you used. Unfortunately, it is your body weight and your body shape. Whether we like it or not, that is there. It is your wig. It is your props. You know, there's all these different criteria on how people are judging your costume. And in the nature of receiving it, sometimes it can feel kind of harsh when someone is telling you that something is wrong with your costume. Although there is a big difference between someone telling you your costume sucks, because that's jerks being jerks, versus you could have done this to your costume. Now, the caveat aside of words chosen of the context and the syntax of your sentence when you criticize somebody, you know, word choice makes a difference. If you say something one way versus another, it makes a difference. That aside, generally if people tell you that something needs to be changed on your cosplay, it's because they're trying to help you.
Yeah.
So when you are receiving that criticism, try to take it in that light. You know, it's, I don't think most people, when they tell you something like that, whether they're cosplay or not, I don't think they're trying to bring you down.
Yeah, usually it's not with a mean intent. It's usually to try to assist you and make it better, because they know that you can do better. And I know, having judged a couple of contests now, and I hear other judges do the same thing, they want you to do your best. And they're like, you know, we know that you can do better than this, and it's helped to push you and help motivate you to keep going. So it's not meant to be something to bring you down. Absolutely.
Well, it's also usually not meant to be personal to you.
Right.
The person may or may not even know you. So they don't necessarily know what you're capable of. They don't know what sort of work that it took you to make that costume. You know, you could have had three jobs during the time, and you scrimped together what you could. Or you could have all the money in the world and just felt lazy. Or you could have, you know, been on a budget and made a fantastic costume. They don't know that. 99% of the time. Judges can sometimes tell. That's the one thing about getting criticism from cosplayers, is that usually they've been there. So they can tell a little bit better than non-cosplayers. Yep. But for the most part, the person doesn't know you personally. So don't necessarily take criticism personally, because it's not aimed at you as a person. It's kind of aimed at you as a general entity. You are a person wearing costume trying to portray character.
Exactly.
So that's, you know, something to think about when someone is criticizing you. But also something to take in mind is you need to figure out what you can change about your costume and what you can't. Someone may tell you, you should have used this material for your cosplay. Well, if you are allergic to that material, then that's not something that you can change. It's not a critique that you can put into, you know, construction.
But if the material was, like, ridiculously expensive, like, you decided to go with a cheaper satin versus the really high quality expensive satin, which does exist and is ridiculously overpriced.
Things like that do exist. Sometimes if you're on a tight budget, do what you gotta do. And people will criticize you for it. Because they may not necessarily know better, or they're looking for perfection.
Right.
Which is kind of really tough on the receiving end, because basically, nobody will ever achieve perfection. So being criticized against that basically means you're always going to be criticized, because you will never reach perfection.
Right.
We're all striving for it. Right?
I hope so.
You know, none of us is perfect, and we're all continually striving for it. So if the criteria is perfection, you're always going to get criticized, which is also why we say don't take it personally, because you're being judged against an impersonal standard. 90% of characters that are cosplayed don't exist in real life anyway. there's nothing to base it on, so, you know, if somebody says, you don't look exactly like this person in the manga, well, unless you have the author and illustrator of that manga standing in front of you telling you exactly how that person is supposed to look, you're being judged on an interpretation.
Mm-hmm.
Not on a real-life person who actually exists that you can compare to.
My logic is, there is this thing called gravity and physics. There are things that go on in manga and anime and video games that just cannot physically happen in the real world.
Science.
I know. I try to defy this a lot, and it just does not happen, so I have to manipulate it to fit me.
Agreed.
Like, and you know very well that there are certain characters where it's like their chest would not exist in reality, else her back would be broken.
Right.
And she would not be able to move. Therefore, that is just not going to happen, people. So, of course, I will be wearing straps with this dress. Thank you very much.
there is Barbie syndrome.
Yes.
And speaking of Barbie syndrome, for those cosplayers who have a different body shape, doesn't have to be overweight, just different body shape. Could even be disabled, maybe. They're going to get criticism more often than not simply because the style of anime tends to endorse a certain body type.
Right.
So, in receiving that, just bear in mind that they're basically judging you against an impossible standard. Not everyone's going to look like a stick-thin 14-year-old Japanese girl.
That would be awesome.
So, don't take that harshly to heart when somebody says that you are the wrong body shape or you're the wrong color, you're the wrong race, wrong gender, whatever. Don't take that to heart too much simply because someone says you're doing it wrong. Do whatever that makes you happy. You know, just because somebody says, you know, like, I'm not flat-chested like Lena Inverse. I am busty. So somebody might say, well, you're too busty to play her. I don't take that personally because I'm being judged against a 14-year-old Japanese girl who's an A cup.
Mm-hmm.
I physically cannot do that very well without being uncomfortable or in pain, so I choose openly to do my costume this way. And yeah, I know in advance that that might invite criticism. But it makes me happy and comfortable, and that's really all that matters, criticism or not. So that's, I just wanted to make sure I say that for those who are, you know, of varied body shapes, body sizes, body weights, you know, race, gender, ethnicity, religion, doesn't matter. You know, don't take it personally.
Yeah, to add on, when we get criticism, a lot of the time it happens online. I mean, very rarely you're going to get it face-to-face unless you're asking someone directly, hey, what do you think I should do with my costume? Yeah, you'll have a couple people that'll come up that'll be like, maybe you should think about tweaking this, but that doesn't happen very often. Typically, you'll get the criticism online where they can't make you face-to-face and you can't punch them or verbally assault them.
Well, this discounts competition, too.
Right.
So competition aside.
Competition aside, of course. But even then, I mean, unless, like you said, unless you are something where you're completely different body size, body type, different race, you're probably going to get more criticism than normal.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. Which is something you expect in competition. You're going to get criticized. But like you said, it's because they want you to improve.
Exactly. It's not meant to be mean or malicious or evil, I promise. We really just want you guys to do better, I swear.
Right. So actually, speaking of judging, giving criticism as a cosplayer.
Mm-hmm. Which I finally did for once! Like, not that long ago!
It can be a really big temptation as a cosplayer to be overcritical.
Yes.
Because you've been there.
Especially if it's a character that you have cosplayed before.
Mm-hmm. So, as a judge, did you want to take a little more off on this one?
Well, it's weird for me because even though I've judged competitions, I mean, I haven't really gone through and personally judged a cosplayer until like a month and a half ago on CosCom. And she was doing Jean from Bayonetta, which was the first costume I won a competition in. So for me, I have a very strong relationship to that character. And I was like, this girl has a lot of good potential. She's got a great base going. She just needs to make a couple of tweaks here and there to really make the costume pop. So I spent the time, I wrote out descriptions, I said, this is the things I really, really like, here are the things that I think you need to work on, but overall, I think you got a great base. She didn't respond to it, but which is okay. And really, it's just, for me, it's about being honest with the cosplayer, but not to be demeaning to them, if that kind of makes any sense.
Does to me.
Yeah. It's because I'm not the type of person that'll say, your costume sucks. I'm the type of person that'll say, I think you have something really good going here, but you might want to consider ironing your costume next time, or you probably don't want to use ribbon as bias tape because it tends to wrinkle and crinkle. Here's some good tips on how to make bias tape. Mm-hmm. Or that's how I typically approach it.
I actually end up having the odd problem of not wanting to say negative things at all.
Yeah.
Because
I think most
cosplayers
are like that.
Having been there, I know what it can be to go through hell to make a particular costume, especially if it's a dream costume of yours.
Mm-hmm.
Especially, you know, a lot of cosplayers are students. They're on tight budgets and they have really tight schedules. So I totally understand that. So that when I see a cosplayer, I tend to want to pick out aspects of their costume that I really like.
I do that
but
too.
I don't touch very much, if at all, on any negative aspects unless asked.
Mm-hmm.
And I think
you and like 99% of the cosplayers do the exact same thing. And that's what I typically do, is I focus on the good things. I very, very rarely pick on the negative stuff unless it's a competition setting. But even then, I'm pretty reserved.
I'm gonna get down on myself, though, because I honestly think that does a disservice to the cosplayer.
Mm-hmm.
You're never going to improve unless someone tells you what you can do better.
Yeah, I'm
you know,
with you that one, too.
We don't always see our own flaws, so sometimes it takes somebody else bonking us over the head with it, going, excuse me, did you know that you have a ripped seam in the back that you didn't notice? Or your trim is coming up. You should probably not glue your trims down. You should stitch them down.
Yeah.
Or, you know, your wig is looking a little flat. Here's some styling stuff that I recommend that you might use to be able to make it, you know, spike stick up better. So I think that as much as that's kind of a really good feel-good sort of thing for the cosplay community, it honestly does them a disservice if you don't tell them how to improve. And in that vein, any cosplayer can criticize any other cosplayer, but it really helps when the experienced ones step up to tell others, you know, here's what you can do to improve this. Here's what I found works. Or here are some resources that you can consult to make this better. Especially from those who are really good at doing a particular thing. So if you're really good at spiking wigs, yes, tell people how they can improve their spiked wigs by all means.
Right.
And share the resources so that, you know, everybody else can improve too.
Mm.
So it does take guts to tell a cosplayer that something's wrong with the costume.
Yeah, because it does.
Some of them genuinely get really angry or upset. I'm sure cosplayers have cried over criticism.
Yeah, I'm sure they have too.
You know, especially if it's a costume that they put blood, sweat, and tears into, and it's their favorite costume, it's the only one they ever have, and they go out because, you know, part of what we do is looking for attention, positive attention, so when you give them that negative attention, it just goes and their self-esteem level drops, so this is one of those times where you have to be careful of how you say it.
Yeah, and when to say it. Because usually I don't give criticism unless, or any type of review unless they ask me for it. Because I feel very weird going up to somebody and saying, hey, I think you need to fix this little thing. That's just not me. That's not who I am in any way. If they ask for the criticism, then I will be glad to give them my perception and my point of view. But
one of the few times that is actually kind of useful to give them criticism is if you're doing photography.
Yeah.
To where after you're done taking the photos, you know, you can walk up to them, you know, show them the photos and say, you know, I think this would improve how your costume looks in photos. Or you could point out, you know, if anything was flawed, like if they had trim coming off, you can fix that in Photoshop, but if they have any other pictures of them taken that day, they're probably going to want to know about it.
Exactly.
So it's okay to point it out just kind of in private, you know, after you're done taking the photos. Say, excuse me, did you realize this? Or, hey, here's some tips on how you can improve how this looks in photos. you know, I've had experience with this, because a lot of photographers were cosplayers at one point.
Mm-hmm.
Even if they're not now. They were. Not all of them, but some of them.
But some of them are.
Yeah.
Some of them are just creepy stalkers.
Oh, well. Segueing from that, photographers who are not cosplayers, and anybody who's a non-cosplayer, it's a little harder for us to speak to giving criticism as a non-cosplayer, because we've been cosplayers for so long, it's kind of hard to remember back in the day.
Back in the old school days.
And heck, I was like 16 when I first... No, I was 14 when I first started cosplaying. So I was back in 8th grade at that point. So that's kind of a really, really long time to remember back.
I've only been cosplaying for like 4 years. I'm still a baby.
But
I've been sewing for like 20, so, you know.
That helps. And speaking of that, actually, something that non-cosplayers should consider when giving criticism is that, as we said before, you are comparing cosplayers to an ideal of some sort. Manga, anime, video game.
Unrealistic ideal.
It is usually unrealistic unless it is a live-action movie where the character is not CG'd in any way. So if you were cosplaying, say, from the movie Thor, those costumes really do exist. Those people really do exist. They were actually made physically represented for the movie. So, yeah, you can compare people to them. However, you know, since no two people are identical unless you're identical twins, chances are very good the cosplayer is not going to look exactly like them, so it's a little difficult to do an identical comparison.
Right.
So, bear in mind what you're comparing to. Something else to think about is that I would venture to say 95% of cosplayers do not have movie-level budgets. They can't buy the really nice naga hide and leather. They can't buy the Dupioni silk. You know, they can't buy hand-woven suede.
Oh.
Or, you know, 100% organic cotton. Most cosplayers can't afford these things, just because...
It'd be so awesome if we could!
Horrendously expensive.
Oh.
Just like, you know, quite a few cosplayers don't have sergers. Most cosplayers don't have a leather machine or a leather sewing machine.
Yeah. I got the basics, and that's about it.
A lot of cosplayers don't have the makings for armor.
Mm-hmm.
So... Think about the fact that a lot of them are on limited budgets, so it's not going to look just like the movie. If it's anime and manga, or video games. Yeah, that thing called gravity. It exists in our world. So whenever they're doing or wearing gravity-defying things, or having gravity-defying hair for that matter,
woo-hoo!
Cosplayers really do their best to approximate what it looks like, but we have to kind of work within the laws of physics, so it's not going to look just like you see it
exactly
on the screen. They're doing the best they can, most of the time. There are some slackers in cosplayers, I admit. But, you know, ours aren't going to defy gravity. We haven't mm-hmm. learned how to do that yet. And now I have the song in my head from Wicked. Fantastic song, by the way. So that's something else to think about. The last thing to think about is that there are differing skill levels of cosplay, and you cannot necessarily tell a person's skill level by just looking at the costume they're wearing.
Right.
The costume may have been purchased. They may not have made it themselves at all. It may have been commissioned from someone who knows what they're doing. It may have been commissioned from someone that doesn't. You know, it may have been bought overseas. They may have made it themselves in a hurry, self-teaching themselves sewing. Or the person could have been sewing for, you know, 24 years already. Normally, the people that have been doing it for a while, you can tell.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean they didn't buy it from someone who knows what they're doing.
Doing, exactly.
So, you can't necessarily tell the skill level of the cosplayer, or even if they made their own costume, just by looking at them.
I think with that as well is that everybody has different sets of skills. Like, for me, I know a lot about how to work with fabric and to work with paint. I know jack squat about how to work with props and how to make armor and all that stuff. It's stuff that I'm having to teach myself. So it's all a learning process. No, none of us know how to do this from the moment that we touch our sewing machines. We all had to be taught, and we all had to teach ourselves. So I think people need to keep in mind that there are a lot of different skill sets that go into making just one costume. It's a beat down when they start criticizing every single, and in a negative fashion too, is what I'm trying to get at, is when they negatively say all these things and don't realize all the work and effort that has to go into each and every costume.
Yeah, receiving from non-cosplayers is actually probably the harshest, simply because they don't know any better. By non-cosplayer, incidentally, I mean someone who has never cosplayed. Not someone who has cosplayed and stopped, because they're still in the know, but someone who has never cosplayed before.
Right.
And, you know, with that, they're probably going to be the harshest critics, because they have the most expectation of perfection without knowing what it takes to get there.
Exactly.
So, you know, all the things we said before apply. Don't take it too personally. Don't take it too harshly. Use it as a learning experience. Improve upon it. Yes, it's probably still going to hurt initially, but, you know, file through what you can use and what you can't, and then decide, do I have the skill or ability, or can I learn the skill or ability to improve it, and then go out and do it. As it is with anything in life.
Exactly. You
know, this isn't necessarily limited to cosplay, but there are things specific to cosplay that come into play.
Exactly.
So, I guess all in all, learning experience is probably the takeaway from criticism and cosplay, is learning experience for everybody all around, both positive and negative. Mm-hmm. You know, I hate doing the negative.
We all hate doing the negative, because especially since we're still such a small knit community and we're so close to one another, that we feel really, I feel bad anytime I try to give any negative feedback, but I know that they need to hear it in order to improve. So it's just one of the things, you gotta suck it up and do it.
Actually, I think the easiest people for me to receive from are cosplayers that are close.
Yes.
Like community cosplayers that I've become associated with. They are the easiest ones that I can take criticism from.
Mm-hmm.
And I find it hardest to take criticism from cosplayers that I don't know.
Yeah.
Because non-cosplayers will usually recognize the level of work I do.
Mm-hmm.
Cosplayers can't always do that. And they're, you know, cosplayers compare to perfection too. It's not just non-cosplayers. And anybody can do it. Heck, mm-hmm. I compare myself to perfection sometimes. Gravity defying or not, I tell myself that one day I will defy gravity. But
if you figure out how to do that, can you teach me?
I'll trade you. You teach me how to fit more hours into my day, and I'll teach you how to defy gravity.
Yeah. Okay, I'll let you borrow the gnomes.
Oh, I want my TARDIS back. That's how I'm spending time.
Oh, yeah. I have your TARDIS.
Give it back. Give it back.
It's sitting in the corner of my room. I'll give it to you.
Collecting dust, I'm sure.
No, it's fine. You still owe me my book, too, so.
Yeah, I know.
I forgot about that.
Yeah. As you can see behind me, I've got cockroach killers of books I'm studying.
Woohoo!
Those are my textbooks. That's what's keeping me busy and off of cosplay right now. Although, incidentally, hopefully soon I should be filming a segment on doing wings, or at least wing covers, and wing anatomy, and that sort of thing.
Which would probably be a whole lot better than mine, because, yeah.
Yeah, we'll see. I have the pattern. The pattern is actually, I want to say 6 feet tall. It's taller than me.
Was it the one that you were working on when I went to go get the business cards?
Yes.
That thing was humongous, but it looked really cool.
Uh-huh. I'm going to transfer it onto fabric, and it will look cool. I hope.
I think it will.
Yeah, I have to figure out where to store it. It's one of the only, one of the only things about whenever you're making cosplay patterns that are large or
large.
So then you have to figure out where the heck you're going to store it.
Yep.
So if you roll it up in poster board, eventually it acquires that shape. So then
you
use the pattern, you have a rolled up piece of poster board. And the ends like to curl just ever so slightly.
Just slightly.
Make sure you're paying attention.
I've started doing mine on freezer paper just because even if I roll it up, I can easily iron it flat again.
That's true.
So that's been my resource.
Well, I figure one of these days I will have enough, like, 2mm foam on which to do all my patterns.
Yeah.
So I can just take a heat gun to it and flatten it back out. Yeah.
Zap it.
That would be great. I would love to have all my patterns in foam. A little less prone to tearing than poster.
Yep. So that was a fun little tangent, but it's a good, nice segue probably into the next segment.
Yes. Forward once more into the breach, dear friends.
Yay.
Hi guys, Amber here, and I have a different sort of, well, not really a tutorial for you, but more of a demonstration. So, hi, I'm right here. What I'm going to show you is a little bit of work with EVA foam, and I'm actually learning this myself, but I wanted to show you guys a little bit of what it looks like for those of you who are thinking about making your first set of armor. Now, what I've done already is I've purchased a bunch of EVA foam, and the mats come in a giant package that looks like this. Here, in fact, I will zoom out just a little bit. There we go. It comes in a giant anti-fatigue floor mats. Four pieces. And you can get these at Home Depot, Lowe's, Harbor Freight. Just about any good hardware store will have these. They're usually called anti-fatigue mats when you buy them. They're not actually called EVA foam mats. But just in case you get confused, EVA is the same stuff as craft foam that you buy at Hobby Lobby, Joann's, and Michael's. It's just a different thickness. But when you get it, it has a smooth side. Well, it's supposed to be smooth. You can see it's been scored a few times. But it has a smooth side. And it has a textured side. You can see this has kind of cross-hatching on it. Normally, if you use this to make armor, you want to end up having the smooth side on the outside. Just something to think about whenever you're patterning out your pieces, just like you would in sewing fabric. In fact, armor making is quite a bit like sewing fabric. But I've had my pattern, which is here. It actually unfolds. I'm redoing my corset for Athena as basically a learning experiment, so that if this fails, I still have a corset. But I went ahead and traced my pattern pieces, as you can see here, on the foam. It's pretty nice and flexible, and it's fairly thick, if you can see that. You can see it's about as thick as one of my fingers here. It's about a half inch, maybe a little bit less. But it's very durable. And so, since I've traced both my pieces, you'll notice on here you can see a little bit in the light that I have actually cut out around the lines. I've given myself what's a sort of a seam allowance, just in case I screw up. Because it's always good to be able to cut away a little bit of extra foam than it is to try and add it back on, because adding it back on is much, much, much harder. And so I've been cutting it with a basic utility knife. Looks just like this, you know, standard box cutter. Make sure your blades are nice and sharp. It's probably going to take you two cuts to get through the foam because it's so thick. I mean, yes, the blade is long, but the foam is fairly thick, and it's a little bit hard to get all the way through. But you'll notice on here, these are nice clean cuts. I haven't had to do anything to the edges of it. It's also good, if you do end up cutting it using utility knives, to have a self-healing cutting mat. You can get these at even Walmart and Target now. Any place that has a craft department should sell these. They'll be on the same aisle with the scissors and the sewing notions. You can get these in several different sizes too. This is actually kind of a small one. You can get them literally as large as this entire half of my crafting table. Which, in hindsight, I should have gotten one of those, as I found out as I was trying to cut my little pieces that are bigger than my mat. But this, that you see on the side, this is what's called a hot wire cutter or a hot foam cutter, and at the moment it is indeed very, very hot. You can get these at any hobby store. Usually they'll sell them in the floral department because they're actually meant for cutting floral foam instead of EVA foam. But, as you can see, I've already done a couple experimental cuts, and it does actually cut through this stuff as well. However, as I do this on this piece, you'll see that this actually has a pretty big set of downsides. I don't know if you can actually see this on camera, but this is smoking. You can actually see it. There you go. So one of the problems is that this does produce, you know, a pretty decent amount of acrid smoke if you do end up cutting it with a hot wire cutter. Now, you'll note, it does cut. It does make very nice rounded edges, too, if that's what you need. But it does produce a very, very foul-smelling smoke. And speaking of foul, that's actually the second downside, is when you apply a lot of heat, a lot of very directed heat, like wire cutters, to foam, it actually produces a toxic fume. It is not something you want to breathe in. It's very disgusting. It's really not great for you. So, as always, take safety precautions if you're going to go ahead and cut it using the hot wire cutter. You can also actually do a combination of both the utility knife and the hot wire cutter, in that you can go ahead and make your cuts with the utility knife first, and then take the hot knife and run it over the edge to kind of smooth out any burrs. You can run it over fairly quickly. And if you look, this edge is actually lighter. It changes color where I've run the hot knife over the foam, so you can see where you've been. And of course, you can always hold it there for a quick second if you need to, you know, get rid of an edge or something similar. It's all about timing, of course. You'll just have to play around with it to get used to it. You can't just run the hot knife over the serrated edge like this. You see, this is the serrated edge side. I've tried to run the hot knife over the edge of this to try and get rid of those burrs. Unfortunately, it doesn't seem to work. Either the knife doesn't get hot enough, or it's not concentrated enough to where I have to hold it over each and every single little bump if I want to try and get rid of those. This is why normally, if you're going to do this with armor, you make sure the smooth side is on the outside so you don't have to worry about getting rid of this part underneath. A couple of words about EVA foam. Aside from the fact that it's used in garage mats and for little kids' projects, which is a good thing, actually. But EVA foam, as you can tell, is fairly flexible. And when you let it go, it does hold its shape partially. You can see it's still bent, and it is slowly flexing back out. So that's one of the major benefits of making armor out of this foam, is that the armor will remain flexible. If you're looking to make hard armor, you can use EVA foam as the base. You probably won't want to have this as your only material. You can always fiberglass over it. You can use Bondo over it. You can use Wonderflex, Sintra, Friendly Plastic, all sorts of other things, I would imagine. I will find out for sure if any of these damage the foam, because I know that with a lot of these foams, intense concentrated heat will damage them or will permanently deform them, as with the hot wire cutter. So be very careful when you're using thermoplastics directly on the foam, as if you are actually melting the plastic on top of the foam, as it may actually permanently deform the foam. You may want to shape the plastic first and then attach it to your foam. But also, if you push into it, as you notice, it's leaving indentations that slowly fade away. Now, they're still there, granted. You can still tell that I've pushed into this foam. And of course, this is a scrap piece. But this will definitely take a beating. You'll still have indents if somebody runs into you, which is why it's a good thing to coat the top of this several times and then paint it several times so that you won't have to worry about this sort of thing. You can use all of your standard materials that you would with craft foam. You can use watered down school glue, you can use wood glue, you can use Mod Podge, you can use gesso, you can use Plastidip. I have heard that you can even use... you can basically use anything that you want. You can use sealant if you want to, you can use primer if you want to. You can use all sorts of things on EVA foam. It's an incredibly versatile material. And of course, if you end up with extra at the end, you can use them underneath your crafting table as anti-fatigue mats, which is what they were originally meant for. And of course, you can also find EVA foam as camping mats, yoga mats, kids' activity mats. You can find them in rolls at Big Lots. You can find them in even larger rolls if you go through foam selling companies, especially those that service memory foam and mattress foam. So this is an incredibly available product. At most places that I've checked, it's fairly inexpensive, so it's easy to get a hold of in various thicknesses as well. That's something to consider with armor, is how thick do you want it to end up. But let me go ahead and give this a second round of cutting, and I will be right back. Alright, so I'm just about done cutting. One of the things that I've found as I've been cutting is that, unfortunately, as you have your foam, when you cut it, you have to have your knife blade exactly perpendicular to where you want to cut. Unfortunately, because I don't have a cutting guide or anything to show me, you know, at the angle at which I'm cutting or a level, I've cut a slight bevel into the end of my corset, which is not what I want. This side I seem to have done okay, and then this side, unfortunately, I did cut a slight bevel into it. I actually ended up taking out a pair of manicure scissors and trimming off part of the bevel at the very bottom. I actually trimmed back here, where you can see the kind of... There we go. You can see the rough edge back here, where I've cut using the manicure scissors, which is kind of unfortunate. So what I may end up having to do is take the hot knife later, on a day when I can actually get ventilation in my room, since unfortunately it is pretty close to 9 o'clock at night, so unfortunately I won't be going outside right now. Plus, it's Texas, and it's like 102 degrees outside. So I'm going to go ahead and finish cutting this using my utility knife. I do recommend that if you do this, don't do as I'm doing at the moment, and wear hand protection. And also, normally cutting rules will tell you to cut away from you. Unfortunately, I am not capable of doing that accurately, so do as I say, not as I do, of course, in this particular demonstration. So I set the knife blade perpendicular as close as I can get it, give it a good firm push, and then cut carefully along the lines. This sort of technique seems to work best whenever you have very straight lines or very gently curved lines, which is what I have here. So there's that one there. And you'll notice that as I peel this off, you can tell I didn't actually get the full cut the first time. So I'm going to insert my blade again and slide it through along the groove that I've already cut, and you can actually hear the sort of unzipping sound as I cut through the diamond back. And there you go. That is a pretty darn clean cut, as you can see. I shouldn't have to use the hot knife very much. The only reason I really need the hot knife is, once again, I've cut a very slight bevel into this, so I need to actually take away that bevel. And I need to make sure that all the sides are even. So again, on the last cut, in fact, I'm going to cut this direction. You can actually cut in whatever direction makes you happy. Just, as you can see, the one disadvantage to this particular direction is that the blade is very, very uncomfortably close to my fingers. So it's just like cutting a normal seam when sewing. Cut as close to the original line as you can. There's that. See, I actually got a much cleaner cut that time, as I can actually just pull away here. And this is where I can actually cut away from myself. There's that. And poof! Oh, no. There we go. Alright. Always retract the blade when you're done so that you don't stab yourself later. You really don't want to get blood all over the very, very nice piece that you just cut. So, there we have my nice shaped corset piece that is unfortunately scored on the front, but we will be taking care of that because EVA foam is also sandable. So I will return in a future tutorial once I have knocked out the unfortunate involuntary bevels that I've put into my corset, and we will proceed further with the project. I hope you've enjoyed.
And we're back again! I was gonna sing, but I didn't.
Okay, Captain.
I was gonna sing it because there's so many songs, you know, with being back again. But I didn't think the audience wanted to hear me sing. Just probably.
You got back in the saddle again. You got back in black. I'm gonna go for all the rock songs.
Yeah, no thanks. This is why I picked up an instrument in school, because I can't sing.
There you go.
But at any rate, hopefully you guys found this episode informative. As usual, we try. However, if you have suggestions, questions, comments, concerns, you can reach us via email at podcast@cospod.org. You can also reach us via Twitter at cospodcast. You can reach us on Facebook, facebook.com/cosplaypodcast.
We update daily on the Facebook now.
Yeah, I would update Twitter, but sometimes I forget. We are also on DeviantArt, cospod.deviantart.com. We're also on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel that has all of our videos on it, plus a little bit more. It is youtube.com/user/cospodcast, I think.
Yeah, you got it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not Cosplay Podcast. You're right. It's Cos Podcast.
Okay. So yes, you can find us on YouTube as well. And I'm sure we will find other ways to be on the internets beyond this as well.
The interwebs is taking over.
Yes. So at any rate, we will see you next time. Until then, Cospotters.
Signing off.
Bye.
Bye.